Welcome to Information Service Engineering. This is lecture number 12, Basic Machine Learning, part 3. In this part of the lecture, we are going to continue neural networks and deep learning. And in the last section, we have learned about perceptrons. And we have learned that these simple or single layer perceptrons, they have a drawback. Of course, they have the limitation because they can only be applied successfully on problems which are linearly separable. Okay, so what can we do? Of course, we can overcome this kind of limitation by using, let's say, non-monotonic activation functions. So instead of the simple sine function, we could use, let's say, a non-linear activation function. And we could use multi-layers instead of just one layer, so that you have some layers in between the output and the input layer, which cannot be seen from the outside, which means they are so-called hidden layers. And why are we doing this? I mean, first of all, if in the hidden layer all of the activation functions would be linear, we could substitute simply then this multi-layer neural network with a single-layer perceptron. We don't want to do that, so therefore we also want to have these kind of more complicated functions. And why do we want to have these complicated functions? Simply, if we compare these artificial neural networks with the brain, and the neural networks in the brain, the biological networks, then of course there's a huge difference. First of all, there are many types of neurons in the brain, not only one specific type. And these dendrites that interconnect the neurons, they can perform complex nonlinear computations. Also, the weights that you have here in the synapses, this is not a simple weight, but this is a complex nonlinear dynamical system. And of course, therefore, it's a good idea, let's say, to put a bit more complexity into our artificial neural network model. The only problem so far was that, of course, if we are using the standard learning algorithm, which usually does one thing, so you compute with your activation function your output, and then you simply try to adapt your weight by the difference between the desired output and the actually computed output. But how do I do this for the hidden layers? So I have no idea what's there, the desired output. This is, of course, a bit more complicated. And for that, it took until 1986, until, of course, people came up with the so-called backpropagation algorithm, which solved exactly this kind of issue. So don't worry, we won't go into mathematics. I simply will explain you how, in principle, this backpropagation algorithm introduced by Rummelhardt and Hinton really works. So you distinguish in this algorithm two kind of phases. You have the forward phase and you have the backward phase. Let's begin with the forward phase, so forward propagation. What you do is, okay, the synaptic weights of your network are fixed and your input signal is propagated through the network layer by layer until it reaches the output and it changes only the activation potentials and output. Okay, you have now computed an output. What you do then in backpropagation is the following. So an error signal is produced by comparing the network output with a desired response. And this resulting error signal then is propagated through the network layer by layer with the help of the backward propagation in backward direction. And by that, of course, you can compute, or you are able to compute exactly this kind of delta adaption for the weights. We won't go into mathematics for that. It's a bit more complicated, but in the end, it works. Okay, and what you do then there is a successive adjustment to the synaptic weights of the network. And then again, you repeat the process and you continue this until, of course, you converge at some point, or you stop simply learning and adapting to weights because you do not want to overfit. So it's the same for all of these kind of machine learning problems. You have to stop when you, let's say, the maximum capability of generalization of your network has been achieved, and not when it overfits for the data that you are computing. The most important thing here for a neural network is, of course, what are you feeding into the input? And this means you have, of course, we said that already in the last part of the lecture, by formulating your problem accordingly, which means you have to derive to solve your problem specific features that you are using as input. And to derive these kind of features, this process is referred to as feature engineering, which is of course a rather complex problem. So the quality of your machine learning approach always depends on the appropriate assembly of the features used for learning, not only for neural networks. In general, this holds for machine learning. We have already seen this with the examples we have computed in the Colab notebooks. So feature engineering is the process of using domain knowledge. So you have to know, of course, about the things you are doing and you are dealing with of the data to create features that make machine learning algorithms work. So you remember we have looked, for example, when we want to make a classification, we have looked for correlation between specific features and then chosen those features where there was, let's say, a high likelihood that they would influence each other. Okay, when working on a machine learning problem, feature engineering is manually designing what the input XI should be. So this is a manual process. You have to put your thoughts into it. You have to know about the domain you are dealing with. Of course, there are a few helpers like correlation analysis, for example, but in general, it pays off also to have an expert on board who can tell you, yeah, probably you should include, let's say, the edges in an image if you want to do object detection or something like that. So coming up with the appropriate features usually is difficult, it's time consuming, and it requires somehow expert knowledge. So this is a difficult task. Point. We will see that nowadays with deep learning, it's also, we are capable of learning features, but we have to wait a little bit until we come to that. So in the second heydays of neural networks, when backpropagation was invented, so in the mid 1980s, early 1990s, these were the limiting factors why artificial intelligence was not really able to take off, because it was so difficult to create these, let's say, the appropriate features for specific problems. But there were even more problems. Just imagine, you want to create a deep learning network. Deep learning means you have multiple layers of artificial neurons. And let's assume you have large layers. So here in this example, assume our hidden layers each contain 1,000 nodes. If they are fully connected, and this is what they are, you have to keep track, at least for only for the hidden layers, of 2 million parameters. They have to be optimized. And this is already a lot, and this is only a small network. So this, of course, is already a rather complex problem, considering the hardware that was available in the 1980s, 1990s, but also today. And the second thing is, if you want to do image classification, for example, with a network like that, then yeah, it's really, really difficult to choose spatial invariant features, because otherwise, you know, you lose generalization, because you should, of course, identify a specific object from different angles, from different sides. So this, of course, is a difficult and was a difficult problem. And this also was one of the reasons why we got stuck in a second kind of AI winter, which started in the late 1990s and lasted until the mid 2000s. So what happened next? What happened next was representational learning, deep learning, and convolutional neural networks. What is representation learning? So representation learning is a set of methods that allows a machine to be fed with raw data, not with its specific features, but with raw data, and to automatically discover the representations needed for detection or classification. So this means we learn the features. And deep learning methods are representation learning methods with multiple levels of representations in them. So what we are doing here is representation learning now, and we are learning the features. For this, let's have a brief view how, let's say, an image analysis is done. So this was one of the, or is still one of the most challenging tasks here. And usually nowadays, they are quite robust. They are working quite well because already, let's say, huge trained networks where in the training, billions of pictures have been used in the end, are available and can be adapted to exactly our kind of problem. But let's stick to the basics. So let's imagine we have here an image of a cat. The cat has to be identified, you know, also if another viewpoint is chosen. So if you have viewpoint variations, Also if the background clutters, if you have different kind of illumination, let's say it's light, it's dark, you have different, you have different occlusions. So the body of the cat might be occluded at some point. You might have deformations because the cat is stretching. And of course, there are lots of variations. So cats can look completely different. How is the image represented in the computer? So this is usually a tensor. So this means this is a sequence of matrices for each of the color channels. You have a matrix for the image because each of these pixels, it's of course spatially arranged. So in a two-dimensional field, so this is a matrix, and you put another dimension on it, what you have is then a tensor. So this means you have three channels for red, green, and blue. And then let's assume you have a specific picture size 800 by 600, and each single value can have, if it's represented by one byte, it can have 256 different values. So you see here this field of numbers, this is all what the computer really sees. And the nice thing is, of course, in feature engineering, you have to think of, yeah, what am I filtering now and putting into my neural network. I can do, for example, edges. I do edge detection and stuff like that. I do detect edge direction and all the stuff like that. I can put in their luminance values. I could put in their chrominance values and so on and so on. So it's endless what kind of features you might use here, but you can learn them. And this is really was a great idea. So these are the so-called convolutional neural networks, CNNs. So this is a special type of neural network for specially processing spatially arranged data like images, because there, of course, the pixels, the inputs are arranged here in a spatial order, in a specific spatial order and pattern. So this is a two-dimensional matrix. They are very, very well adapted for visual analysis tasks. Nowadays, you can also apply them to other kind, let's say natural language processing tasks and stuff like that. And they are, of course, based on two fundamental blocks. One are the so-called convolutional layers, and the other one are the pooling layers. So you see this here. These are these broad boxes you have in there that come before the classification layers, which are fully connected layers like we know them already in a multi-layer connected network. But of course, then when you do this kind of filtering and feature generation beforehand, then the classification layer, the fully connected layer, can become much smaller, and the features are already optimized. Even more, what is even better, when you have trained your network sufficiently that it's able to capture the idea of the image and to distinguish images accordingly, then the processing pipeline before the classification acts somehow in a way like the visual cortex in a brain, which means this is already trained. The perfect features will be captured by that. So you can reuse this and simply then adapt it to a new classification layer and train it, let's say, to new classes or to new type of images. This is then called transfer learning. We will go into that later on. But this is, of course, one of the major benefits you have from this kind of architecture. So you have convolutional layers, they do the feature extraction, and you have pooling layers, they compress and aggregate the information, which means in the end they save you a lot of parameters that you might need. Let's have a quick look into convolution and pooling layers. So you have to imagine that, of course, the image is fed into the neural network, which starts with convolution layers, and there, let's say a small area goes like a window over, row by row over this image. You see this here. And what it does there, it computes a so-called filter kernel. So each neuron checks a specific area of the input field using a filter kernel. And a filter kernel examines the image for certain features, like, for example, for the color, for the edge, for the brightness, and other stuff. So the result of a filter is then a weighted input of a range and is stored in its convolutional layer. And you can have many convolutional layers, and so you speak from the depths of your convolutional layers, because this is then a number of filters which are applied and which in the end are the kind of output you want to have there. So this is your convolutional layer. And then you do subsampling, which means you try to aggregate, to, let's say, make the number of parameters that you need in the end smaller. So this is the pooling layer there. Information is compressed between the individual convolution layers. And this is done via dimensionality reduction. Again, you have a window that goes, you know, over the picture step by step. And within that range, then, of course, there is an aggregation function, again, a filter function, compressing function going on. Like, for example, the maximum of values that is found in that region is chosen as a representation or a representer for the entire region, or the average is chosen. So can be different kind of pooling layers there. So this is the basic idea. And then usually in this kind of architectures, convolutional layers and pooling layers, they come all alternating, and they first start large, and then sometimes they become smaller before you have all your feature extraction done. And then comes usually the fully connected neural network layer, which then takes over the classification. However, for all of them, the weights are learned. And thereby, by using now a large number of input pictures, this entire visual processing pipeline that you have in the beginning, so the convolution and the pooling layers, all their values that are stored there in their weights, they can be saved and then applied to other kind of problems. And then is something like, you know, here, transfer learning. Transfer learning is a new task, and that depends on a previously learned task. So what you do is, for deep learning, you use off-the-shelf pre-trained models as feature extractors, and then you do a fine-tuning of the off-shelf pre-trained model via supervised domain adaption. So what you do is, you are replacing either completely the fully connected layer or the last layers of the fully connected layer. This is what you do in the end. And by that, for example, what you can do, you can use a fully trained network off the shelf that does usually image classification, and you might retrain it then, or fine tune it, let's say, for art epoch detection or artist detection, if you apply this then to art, and it works. Or you can simply train it on new classes, and this works really, really well. So deep learning architectures nowadays consist of, you know, these kind of lots of different layers and complex architectures, sophisticated architectures that combine in the end fully connected layers with these two kind of feature extraction layers that we have already learned of. These are convolutional layers and pooling layers, and there are also different kind of layers. So for example, you can use recurrent neural networks, which have a feedback loop somehow, and by that somehow some kind of a memory also. Or you can use long-term memory cells, which also are working with a kind of memory. And there are even more. So you can, for example, use also encoder, autoencoder, attention layers, and so on. So the list is long and grows because there are new things going on and also are invented. So new architectures pop up every day. And this is an ongoing field of research. And I think we will also see lots of interesting things coming up in the near future there. So this was a quick, very quick and rough introduction into deep learning. In the next section of the lecture, we will look at a few examples, what else is going on. And besides classification, we also know that neural networks are able to create something, so they can generate something. And we will have a look at so-called generative adversarial networks, for example. But this then will be subject of the third part of this lecture.